Hello and welcome to Developer Perspective. Today we'll be trying out RabbitMQ using the JavaScript SDK. If you want to know what is RabbitMQ and how it works, you can check out my other video related to RabbitMQ. You will be shown the link to the video on the info button at the top right of your screen. You can also find the link in the description below. So let's get started with the implementation. So to start the implementation of RabbitMQ, first we need to install the RabbitMQ server. So to do that, let's go to rabbitmq.com. Here you will find the Get Started button. Then you need to click the Download and Installation. I'll be using the Docker image of the RabbitMQ to host my RabbitMQ server on my local Docker machine. So we have a command to execute the RabbitMQ along with the RabbitMQ management tool. So just copy this command and go to your Docker terminal and execute. Once the RabbitMQ server is up, then just go to localhost 15672. So this will open the RabbitMQ management console. Here, just put in your username as password as guest, which is the default username and password for RabbitMQ management tool. Here, you will find all the different components or all the different modules of a RabbitMQ. You will find connection, channels, exchange, and queues. Now to do a hands-on implementation of a RabbitMQ, you can go to RabbitMQ tutorials. Here you will find a lot of implementation tutorials which you can go and explore, and there are a lot of technologies which have SDKs created for RabbitMQ. So you will have for SDKs for Python, Java, Ruby, PHP, C Sharp, JavaScript, Go and many more. I'll be using the JavaScript SDK and trying out this implementation. So to do so, you need to create a project and then you need to install the AMQP library. So to install AMQP library, you need to do npm install amqplib. So I started by creating a new project of RabbitMQ. So to create a node based JavaScript project, I'll be using npm init to initiate the creation of the project. Once that is done, I will need to install the AMQP library by using npm install amqplib. So to start creating the producer and the consumer code, so what I'll do is I'll create two JavaScript files. One I'll name it as sender.js and the other would be receiver.js. So we'll start with the sender.js first. So first you need to import a package of amqplib. Then we need to create a connection to the local AMQP server, that is the RabbitMQ server. So for that you need to do amqp.connect followed by the URL, that would be amqp:localhost. As this will be having a function associated to it, so we'll just have function and that will return you either an error or successful connection. For error handling, you can just have one if condition to check if there is an error and just throw the error back to the application. So now we have the connection with us. So we using that connection will create a new channel and that will also have the same function with error and channel details. Now if the same error is there, then we'll just throw error 1. So our channel has been created. Now let's create a queue for the application. So that would be queue. We'll name this queue as application log and the first log message will be hello world. Now we need to assign this channel with this queue which we want to create. So that will be channel.assertQueue followed by the queue name which we have specified, and we'll just keep this durable as false, as we don't want this to be saved to the disk whenever there's a failure happening to the application. Then we will just send the message to the queue by using send to queue function, followed by the name of the queue and the message. We will add a log at end of this function just to see if the message was sent or not. So we'll just type in message send followed by the message. Also, we will have a set timeout function here just to close the connection if the connection has expired, and we'll keep this for like half a second, and that's it. So this is the sender.js file. So we'll be sending a message of hello world to the application.log. We'll also write the receiver.js code here as well. So here again we will paste the AMQP library reference. Then we'll again have the AMQP connection created to our local RabbitMQ server. So here again we will create the channel, as we don't know if the channel is present or not when we start this application. So we'll always create the channel, and it will not be duplicated. It will always check if it is existing, and if it doesn't exist, only then it will create a channel. Otherwise it will use the same channel. So now we know the queue name of our application was application-log. So we'll bind this receiver to the queue name application-log. Then we'll again check if this queue exists. If not, then it will create a new queue, and I'll just have one console log saying that waiting for message, and we'll also say if you want to exit just press Control C. Then we'll now act as a consumer by using the channel.consume function, which takes in the queue name and has a function which gets the message for you. Here, whenever I receive a message, I will say I received this message by using message.content.toString. So doing so, I'll be able to get the message. And I will also specify what type of queue will this be. Will it have a parameter of acknowledgement? And for this application, so we'll do no acknowledgement as true. So that way I'll be specifying that this consumer will just consume the message and will never give the acknowledgement, and the queue should consider this message to be consumed as soon as it is published to a consumer. So there would be no acknowledgement coming from the consumer for this message. So we are done with the sender and the receiver. So if you see, there is no channels, there is no consumers, or there is no exchange, neither any queues created. Okay, so we'll just test this application out. So to do that, first I will run the receiver, and then followed by I will run the sender. So to do that, you just need to do node receiver.js. So now the receiver or the consumer is waiting for the message to be received. So let's go quickly to the console and let's see what changes happened there. Here if you see, there is a queue created with the name as application log. And if you see the exchange, there is no exchange created here. If you see the channel, there is a channel created here. And if you see the connection, there is a connection running, and which is using the protocol of AMQP. Also, if you go to the queue and click on the application log, you will find the binding present here. And if you see the binding, you will find that there is default exchange is been binding to this queue. Okay. So a queue should always be binded to an exchange. There you cannot directly communicate with a queue. A producer can only connect to an exchange, and that exchange will be able to connect to the queue. So that's the reason if you see this, the default exchange is connected to this queue. Okay. And if you see there is no queue created, that's the reason the default AMQP been used to connect to this queue. And now let's try to produce some messages here. So to produce the message, I will be using node sender.js. So this will send the hello world message. And if you see at the left, you directly get a receive hello world. Okay, so this happened very quickly. So you just send the message and the receiver will receive that message right away. Okay, so let's try to again send the message, and if you see, there's the receiver receiving the message. So now let's see what happens if you have two consumers. Okay, so I'll just create one more consumer here. So I have three console here. So one is the sender, the other I will also make it as the receiver. I'll make this as the receiver. So now if you see, I already have one receiver here. I also created one more receiver, and there is this sender. Okay, let's go to console and see what difference it has. So now if you see, the queue is still one. Okay, but if you go to the queue, you will find two consumers here. Okay, so there was one consumer, now you have two consumers here. Now let's try to publish some message here. So if I publish one message here, the first consumer will get it. If I again try to send, the second consumer will get it. The first consumer will again get the message, the second consumer get the next message. So this happens in a sequence. Okay, so every time you send a message, the first receiver will get the message followed by the second receiver. Okay, so this keeps on happening, and this type of rotation of this receival of message is called the round robin technique. So now if you see, as soon as we send a message, the message has been received by the consumer and the message is destroyed right away. Okay, but now we need to check the message acknowledgement feature of RabbitMQ. If you see, if I just send the message, it received by the first consumer, and if you go to the console and see if there is no messages here, because I just sent it and the consumer picked it up and it processed it right away, and we did not expect it to have an acknowledgement sent back to you because we said that acknowledgement is not required for this queue. So now what we can do is, now let's update the queue to allow acknowledgement enabled messages. So to do that, we would need to create a new queue, because we'll not be able to use this queue as update of properties of this queue is not possible once it is created. So let's go to our code again. Now here I will, instead of using application-log, I will use application-log new. Okay, and the same will update here as well. So that said, now both our application will connect to this application log new queue. So for this queue in the receiver, so here we have the no ACK as true. So instead of that, we'll make it as false. So that said, now acknowledgement has to be enabled for all the queues. So now whenever your request comes to the application, so let's try it out. We'll just send some request here and let's see if that works. So I will start. So I'll start both my consumers. And now try to send messages. So if you see, the message has been received by the consumer. Okay, but if I go to my console and go to the channel, I will see there are two unacknowledged messages pending here. Okay, so there is messages here and it has not been processed. Let me try to send one more. You will find that it has been received here, but the acknowledgement is still pending with the second consumer. Okay, so that's how unacknowledged message will be pending in the queue even if the consumer has been processed the request. Okay, so to enable manual acknowledgement, you need to add a few line of code here. So to simulate some delay in the request processing, we will just add one function with some delays, and once it has been waited for like 5 seconds, we will acknowledge the message. So to acknowledge the message, you need to just say channel.ack followed by the message. So now let me restart my node applications, and if you see, this queue took all the requests and it processed it because all the messages were pending in the queue. So that has been received here and it has been processed right away here. So if you see, there is no unacknowledged message pending here. So now let's try to simulate a consumer failure. So let's try to first send some messages here. So I will just send a message, and if you see, this has been received. I'll send one more message, and that has been received by the first consumer and it has acknowledged. Okay, let's try to send a message again. and that has been received by the second, and I'll just stop the server. So as soon as I stop the server, that has been requeued to the first consumer and it has been processed. So that's how failure doesn't affect your messages, because as soon as I stop the execution from this consumer, the message is routed to the other consumer and that consumer processes your request. So now let's try to implement an exchange. So the first exchange type we will try out is the fanout exchange. So that acts as a publish subscribe connectivity, where producer acts as a publisher and the subscribers are all the consumers. So it has broadcasted throughout all the consumers. So that's the reason it acts as a PubSub application. So to start with the changes here, instead of using the queue, we'll be using an exchange. So we'll just replace the queue name with the exchange name. And we'll name this as application-log exchange. Instead of creating a queue, we'll be creating an exchange. And we'll allow exchange to create its own queue and will not define the queue. It can be auto-generated by the exchange. So we'll just name, refer that exchange name, followed by the type of exchange it would be. So for now, we'll be using fanout. And the durability will be false for this. As of now, and then instead of sending it to the queue, we'll be publishing it right away to the exchange. And we'll keep the next parameter of queue as empty. So this said sender would be sending request direct to the exchange instead of sending it to the queue. And now exchange is responsible for creating the queue according to its need. Now we need to update the receiver code as well to accept exchange as its source. So now I'll just name this as the same as the producer. And here also I will create the exchange using the assert exchange function, followed by the name of the exchange which we are using, and the type of exchange would be fanout, and this would be also the durable false. Once this is done, we will be asserting the queue, but now there would be no queue name here. Instead of that, it would be empty quotes, and this will be defined by the exchange which has been associated to the queue. And here we will keep this as exclusive so that it gets deleted as soon as the work has been completed by the exchange. In here, we need to specify the function which will help us get the newly created queue details, and this entire code has to come inside this function. Then before we are consuming from this channel, first we need to bind that queue to this channel by using bind queue, followed by the queue name and the exchange associated to it. And then instead of the queue, we will be having the reference of queue.queue, which has been created automatically by the exchange. We will also make this as true for now, because we don't want to wait for a long time for the acknowledgement to come, and we'll keep this as a no acknowledgement based application. So that said, we have completed our code changes to make this as an exchange fanout structured RabbitMQ process. So now let's try to again start the receiver, and let me send a new message and see what happens. Awesome. So if you see, I received that message at both the consumers. You will find this application log exchange available here, which is of type fanout. And it creates a queue, two different queue with some default name. So that's the name of the queue created by the exchange. And it's of type exclusive. So as soon as I stop the consumer, I should see that both the queues has been deleted automatically. Whereas this application log stays there because it's not an exclusive queue. So now let's try to implement direct exchange. So that's the type of exchange which works on the basis of binding key and routing key. So you need to bind your receiver with a key, and the sender or the producer will send a routing key along with the message, and that has to match each other so that the queue would be able to get that message by the exchange. So to do that, we may need to do some changes here. So in the bind queue function, you have the queue name, exchange name, and there is a third parameter which is kept as empty. That's the binding key variable, that is what you can pass here. Okay. So here what we will try to do is in this logging application, we may want to have different logging queues for different type of messages or different type of logs. That is, like, if I have error log, I will keep the error log in a different consumer, and the debug info and warning logs would be in a different consumer. Okay, I'll want two different queues for each of these type of logs. So to do that, what I'll do is I'll first register the binding key for each of my receiver. To do this in a dynamic way, I'll get binding free from the command line argument. So to do that, I will first get the argument from the command line by using this function. Now I have all the arguments. So here I will pass the list of binding, the list of binding key for which I need this consumer to respond. So this will be called as log type. So now, on the basis of whatever log type I send to the receiver via the command line, that would be used to create the binding key for that specific queue. In the same way, I need to update the sender as well to send the routing key along with the message. So to do that, I will be using the same args. So I'll be specifying the log type via the first element of the argument, and the message I can just get it from the same argument line by joining everything after the first message, that is the log type. Okay, now what I need to do is when I do a publish, so there is this field which I kept empty, and that was specifically for the routing key. So I just passed the routing key here. So now this exchange will be getting this message which specifies this route key. Change type from fanout to direct. Okay. The same thing you need to do in the receiver as well. Also, we need to change the exchange name, because the parameters of that exchange cannot be updated once it has been created. So we'll just create a new exchange with name exchange dir, that is for direct message, and the same we'll update in receiver as well. So now let's try to create the receiver and sender. So we'll have a receiver which will take error messages, and we'll have another receiver which takes warning, info, and debug messages. Now let's try to send an error message. So the first parameter would be the type of a message, and followed by the message. So now if you see, when I send this error message, only this consumer got the message and this consumer did not get any message. Let's try to send a new message which is of type warn, and let's see what happens now. So I'll just say warning. Now if you see, we got the message here. Okay, now let's try to again send a debug message. Okay, so if you see, routing key and the binding key did not match because the D was capital here. So that's the reason the message was discarded. Okay, so you need to exactly match the key of both the binding and the routing keys. So if I do now, I will be able to send the message. Okay, and if I try to again send an error message, that will be received by this receiver. Okay, so that's how you can bind a specific message to a specific queue, and a specific receiver will receive that message. So now let's see the console. What is the difference that we see in the console? So now if you see, there is a new type of exchange created here, that is the application log exchange, which is of type direct. If you go to the queue, there is this default created by default by the exchange. Now if you see, there are three different routing keys. for this debug info and warn. Okay, so these are the different binding key which has been created. That's the debug info and warn. Okay, in the same way, if you go and check the other one, you will find the error routing key. So this is how the routing key gets assigned to a specific queue and gets binded to the queue. So this is how the direct exchange works. Now we have segregated our messages on the basis of type of log, so that way we'll understand which is the error log, which is the debug log. But in a normal application, that's not the only different segregation you have in your application logs, right? So you have logs coming from your database, you have logs coming from services, and you have logs coming from different features of your application, right? So how do you bind those logs, and how do you make granular setting to your RabbitMQ queues and RabbitMQ consumers so that it can pick that specific error messages from your queue and get it processed or get it printed out. Okay, so to solve this problem and to facilitate these features, we have a third type of exchange, that is a type of topic. So the topic exchange uses a set of words binded together by a dot to create the routing and the binding keys, along with two extra features of star and hash. So star can substitute for exactly one word, whereas hash can substitute for zero or more word in a binding key. So that helps and have larger scope of mapping things to a specific queue or a specific consumer. So let's try to implement the feature of topic exchange to this application. So to make this application run in the fashion of topic exchange, so you just need to change this type of exchange from direct to topic, and you need to change the exchange name. So I'll just create this new name, and here also you need to do the same thing. So that's the only change you need to do in your application. Now let's try to access these changes. So now if my application has a structure of project feature followed by code base from which the log is coming from and the type of log, that's how I'll structure my log type. In that case, I will create one more consumer for my application. Okay. So the first application, so my first application will be receiving all the logs coming from checkout feature. So this will be a type of wildcard which will receive all the checkout logs to this console. The second receiver will plan to get all the error messages, and the third receiver all the messages from the service level of the application where we have the service implementation code. Okay. This said, I have three different receiver polling to three different type of logs. So now let me create a message. So let's try to check out some of the error messages and see what happens when we send this specific type of logs to the sender. The first we'll see is the checkout.db.error, and the message would be error occurred. Okay, and let's see where this message goes. So if you see, the message has been received by the first and the second consumer because the checkout dot hash is satisfied and the TB dot error, so dot star and star error is been satisfied. So that's the reason you are getting these messages at these two places. Now let's try to do the same thing, but now the type of log would be info type and info year. So message would be info year. So now if you see, that message has only been sent to the first one because it just satisfied the first condition of checkout, and there was info error, no error message. So that's the reason it was gone to the first consumer. Now let's check out a new type of log, that would be like cart.service.info followed by some message like info. And if you see, that has been received by this third one because it is only satisfying that service condition. Okay, so that's the reason we got that service here. Now let's try to do some tricky thing like checkout.test.service.error. Okay, this is kind of non-matching thing because normally, as I said in the start, that my structure would be having the three levels of granularity, which includes the feature and the code base is coming from and the type of error. Okay, we have changed the structure. Now let's see if this works. And if you see, it has been received by the first queue or received by the first consumer. That's because the hash will never see how many jumps are there after the dot. Okay, so it will just take in any request which satisfy checkout dot followed by anything. Okay, so that's the reason we were able to send that to that consumer. But if I change this structure to something else, for example, if I just say login, okay, login dot test dot service dot error, where we still have this star dot service dot star, and we also have star dots star dot error, there it should actually match, but it will not match anywhere and the message will be discarded. The reason being, this says star dot service dot star, where we have three different elements delimited by dot, but there is no four element to it. In the same way, the second consumer is pointing to the star dot error, where it requires only three element matching to it, whereas we did not have that three element, we had four element to it. So that's the reason it did not work that way. Okay, so this is how the entire structure works of the topic exchange. For the header exchange, it is almost the same as the topic exchange, but instead of using the routing key, we will be using the header key. So I'll not be showing that, but that's how it works. This is all about how a RabbitMQ works. Hope you understand what are the different ways through which you can experiment on RabbitMQ on the basis of your requirement to your application. Okay. So do let me know in the comments if you like this implementation, and do let me know if you want me to do more specific tutorials on RabbitMQ. Or if you have any questions, feel free to put a comment on this video. I'll be reaching out to you as soon as I get your comments. So thank you for watching.